Resumable indexes add a powerful capability which can make DBAs' lives easier in SQL Server 2017, 2019, and in Azure SQL. Tune into this episode of Data Exposed MVP Edition to learn more. Hi, I'm Anna Hoffman, and welcome to this episode of Data Exposed MVP Edition. Today, I'm joined by John Morehouse, who is a consultant at Denny Cherry and Associates Consulting. And today we're going to talk about resumable indexes. And this is something I don't know a ton about, so I think it would be great if you could start by just explaining, you know, what is this and why should I care about it?
Sure, absolutely. So in SQL Server 2017, Microsoft introduced a concept that allowed us to rebuild an index online and be resumable. What that basically means is that we can actually pause that process and then resume it at a different point in time. It was SQL Server 2019, they actually extended that to allow us to do that same process, you know, start it and pause it. But then we can also add on some extra settings where we can actually throttle the CPU utilization with a max stop hint. And that really helps us as data professionals have one, in my opinion, a better work-life balance, because now I can plan for that activity versus having to do it all in one big fell swoop.
Awesome. And so, you know, we were kind of chatting before this and you said that sometimes or before this was something you might have to do, you know, on a Saturday, very late at night or something like that.
Most definitely. So with customers today, and at least in my experience as a consultant and being in the field for a number of years, clients and customers are not deleting as much data as they used to because storage is more readily available. With the introduction of cloud and Azure and all the offerings that the cloud brings, storage is just, disk is cheap. That's always the phrase we always hear.
Got it.
And so With customers having more data and larger volumes of data in tables, building and rebuilding indexes can be a time-consuming process. And so before this feature was introduced, DBAs in general would have to plan around that to, okay, we have to take an outage because that process could maximize CPU throughput and cause performance issues for the applications. And so this now allows us to have a better work-life balance, in my opinion, as I said, and right. Better control, granular control, as to when that process actually happens. And I can do it in a way that doesn't hinder application performance. And so it's done in a much more controlled manner.
Got it. Awesome. Okay, so that makes sense. I think I now have a baseline of how this thing works and what it's for. Now, from an implementation standpoint, is it very difficult to set up?
So that's a great question. It's because it's an online operation, it is enterprise only. So if you're on premises, you have to have enterprise edition of SQL Server. Now, thankfully, with Azure SQL, you get that straight out of the box. So if you're in Azure SQL already, you've already got that capability already there. It's baked into the product. So that's a really cool feature about Azure SQL. It's really easy to set up. It's really easy to configure. It's just a syntactically change in the alter or the create statement for the index. And so it's really easy to implement and to control.
Awesome. That's great to know that it's available in enterprise, but it's also available in kind of all flavors of Azure SQL. So that's awesome. Now, you know, before we get into a demo, because I know you have something ready, yeah. My last question is, are there any gotchas that we should, you know, really be aware of when we look at this?
Yeah, so the one, and I'm not sure I would classify it as a gotcha. It might be more of a feature. I'm not sure. With the ability to alter and control the max stop, which is the maximum degree of parallelism configuration for the process, when I first looked at this feature, I was really happy about it because if you think about from a DBA perspective and maintenance, if I had a really large table I had to do index maintenance on during the week, you know, during the normal 8 to 5, those are the prime work time that I, you know, my application is really busy. I could limit that and throttle that process to be, you know, one or two, you know, CPU cores. And then in the weekends, if the weekend is an off peak cycle, I could up that maxed up value and really chunk away at that process, you know, because I'm not worried about hindering application performance. I've got the CPU resources available to focus on my process at that point in time. That doesn't actually happen that way. You can actually specify a higher max dot value, and I can show this in the demo. But in reality, under the scenes, SQL Server doesn't actually take that value. It only can take what you originally started the process with. So if you start with a max dot of 2, and you try to set a new max dot value or resume that process with a max dot value of, say, 4, it will take the 4, and the command will succeed, but it doesn't actually use 4, it uses 2.
So
it's kind of a gotcha, but not really. It works, but it's not, in my mind, I was like, oh, cool, that's a really great way to really granularly control when things happen. It doesn't quite work that way.
Yeah, maybe some feedback we can take back to the team.
Sure.
All right, cool. So let's see. I know you wanted to show us. Let's see what you got.
All right, so time for a demo. What I've got here is a local instance of SQL Server 2019. We can see that I've got Worldwide Importers, which is a sample database offered by Microsoft. It's in GitHub if you want to go download it. In this database, I've got a couple tables. And in this case, I've actually got a table, Cold Room Temperatures Archive, this table right here. In this case, it's actually a temporal table. And so I've actually exploded it to be pretty large. I'm going to drop an index on it if it exists, just to make sure it's gone, just for sanity's sake. But I want to prove that it's pretty big, at least big in terms of my local laptop. We can see that it's only got a single clustered index on the table, but it is just almost just shy of 37 million rows, so 36.6 million rows. So it's decent size. Really, I needed a larger size of data sample just so that the demo would actually run slower. Otherwise, it would finish pretty quickly because of local SSDs and the 8 cores on my laptop. So I'm going to create a new non-clustered index, and in this case, it's on that temporal table. I'm going to specify that it is online. Because it's an online operation, it does have to have that syntax there. Otherwise, it'll fail. So it goes in conjunction with the resumable syntax. So I'm going to tell SQL Server that this process is going to be resumable and that I could potentially pause it later in life if I so desired. And in this case, I don't want to use all 6 or 8 cores that I've got on my laptop. So I'm going to throttle this down to 2 cores with that max stop setting. Now, there is an additional setting here that I don't have shown, and it's a duration setting. So I can actually tell SQL Server, hey, run this process for a maximum duration of however many minutes I specify. So if I wanted to say 30 minutes, for example, the index process or the create process would only run for 30 minutes, and it would automatically pause itself, which is really cool. I think that's a really cool feature and really gives the data professionals a really granular control on how this process works. So if I only had a 30-minute window in production, I could use that 30-minute window and be safe in knowing that process is actually going to pause and I don't have to worry about it. So I'm going to kick this off and I'm going to go over to flip a different session. And I'm going to pause it. We're going to see that it paused. Now with the it came out in 2017. That actually Microsoft actually introduced a new DMV, sys.index resumable operations. So I can actually query a DMV and see what resumable operations I might have in flight at that point in time. So looking at this result, we can see that, yep, there's the index name that I'm creating. Here's the actual text I issued. So this also helps from a DBA perspective, because if another DBA kicked it off and I don't know about it, I can actually go query and see exactly what the command was that was issued. I can see what max dot value was used, so I can see whether or not we're throttling. I can see what state it's in. Is it running? Is it paused? What is it? When it started, how far along is it? Is it close to being done? Or how many pages are going to be built into the index? So I can see some of this information. So this is really, really handy. So we know that it's paused. So I'm actually going to go back. And in this case, I'm going to try to resume the operation with a lower max dot. Maybe my system is being overloaded and I need to resume it, but I want to do it even more throttled or gated, and I want to see if that's going to work. Now, unfortunately, it doesn't. So because the execution plan has already been generated and set, I can't lower that value. So what if I went higher? So what if maybe it's now the weekend and I want to try to escalate or accelerate that process? Can I increase that value? Now, we'll see that it's actually running, and it should finish here in a little bit if I flip back over. So now we can see that it finished. And so while it actually did complete, that was that gotcha that I kind of mentioned, is that it doesn't really work. We can't just increase that value, which I thought would be really cool to do. It still does complete. Now, again, this really allows me as a DBA to have more granular control over when I do index operations. And again, 2017, it was just a rebuild. That's great. But if you had to put in a new index, create a new index, you still had to take potentially an outage to do that, depending on what it was doing. With this in 2019 in an Azure SQL, we now have the ability to resume an index operations for a create, which again is a great thing for DBAs because it's all about me, the DBA. That's what I want. So it's a really great feature that I really like. And some people don't know about it yet still. The other cool thing or something to note about is if you start an index create process, you can't just kill it. So if I were to start this over again, start the process, papa, I'm going to pause it. Because there's a value in this DMV already, I can't just stop that process. And I'm limited to what I can actually do to that underlying table. Because that process has already been started, I have to abort it. So there's actually a new command called abort. And so you actually have to tell SQL, abort that process. Until you do, it's going to sit there. Another beauty about this feature is that it's totally durable. So if I have to reboot my box in the middle of the night for some strange reason, that process is still there and SQL Server will pick up wherever it left off. That also means that it's durable for things like availability groups. So if I had a failover in the middle of this, anything that is building in the background will be automatically transferred over to your secondaries. And so you can just pick up where you left off on your secondaries.
Awesome. Thanks, John. That's a really interesting capability that we've added. It seems like in 2017, then we enhanced it in 2019, and you kind of get it out the gate with Azure SQL. So really awesome technology. Thanks for showing it to us and explaining it and making it a little bit easier. I realized I never asked, you know, what do you do at Denny Cherry and Associates?
that's a really great question. So we at Denny Cherry and Associates, a small boutique of SQL Server consultants, nerds is what we usually, I'm a nerd, but we do a lot of really cool things with SQL Server. And we do a lot of work in Azure. So whether it's Azure SQL DB or SQL Server and Azure Virtual Machine or managed instances, we also do a lot of BI work. And so we help clients make their data ecosystems better and faster, whether that's enhancing their on-premises platform or migrating them from on-premises to Azure SQL. To help them really enhance and migrate their data platform to a new and better ecosystem.
Awesome. And so, you know, when you move people to 2019 or to Azure or even 2017, is this one of this technology, one of the things that you're seeing is, you know, greatly increasing and impacting your customers?
So what I'm seeing a lot of is, yes, they want to get to the new version and stuff. This is one of those features that hasn't quite, I think, got out there a lot. I'm really interested in it because it gives me more control over my work-life balance, mm-hmm. as well as gives me more flexibility with my clients when I can do maintenance work. And so that's a better relationship that I have with my clients. If they're on 2019, I can utilize this to make sure, one, I get the work done. In theory, indexes help performance, right? Indexes are magical and make things better. And I've yet to have a client tell me that they want their system to be slower. Right. So if I can make their world better and do so in a way that is, one, controlled, and two, slightly a better work-life balance for myself and my family, then that's great. And so it's what I'm seeing is be able to at least teach the clients or let them know about these features. And this, to me, this is one of the selling features. If I was a DBA, not a consultant, and somebody told me about this feature, I would want to go there, not only because it's a better way to do things from a production standpoint, mm-hmm. but it gives me, the DBA, better work-life balance. And that's important for me. So I was thrilled when Microsoft released this in 2019. I thought it was a great feature. I thought it was a great feature add.
Awesome. Great. Cool. Well, thanks so much, John. I said, this has been really interesting. And I hope that, you know, maybe now more viewers, like you said, this is still a relatively new thing. Hopefully more people now know about it. We'll include some links to Denny Cherry and Associates Consulting, as well as some links in our documentation so you all can learn more. Thanks so much, John, for being on today.
Thanks for having me. I really appreciate it being here.
And if you like this video, please like this video, subscribe to our channel, leave us a comment, and let us know what you're doing with Resumable indexes. Thanks for joining us, and see you next time on Data Exposed.